very first thing, just when you're doing the preamble and intro, did I hear say something about H1 and year 200 million? What was H1?
So that's, sorry, our first half of the year.
So oh, yeah, okay. So H1. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, thank you. And, okay, so that was 200 million growth in the first half. That's what you're talking about.
Yeah.
And that's to contradict what he was saying, reading the guide, or to qualify what he was reading.
Enrich.
Enrich, yeah. Rich is the word of the day.
Yeah.
And the second clarification, thank you, was you distinguished between two types of growth early in your talk as well. You talked about capacity growth.
And yeah. What's your other? Unit revenue growth.
Unit
yeah.
revenue growth. Okay.
So essentially we are, both by buying new planes and by moving from one type of plane to a bigger plane, we're increasing the number of seats we have available. So that's what I would describe as my capacity growth.
Yes.
Which sort of gives me a, I can inflate my numbers because, you know, essentially, if we take more passengers, I'm going to sell some more stuff and I can grow without really doing anything because I'm just getting volume growth. But on top of that, the unit revenue, so our unit is per seat. So for every seat, I'm making 15% more revenue than I was last year.
So we can be talking about spend there.
Yeah.
And then my, thank you for those clarifications. Then my my actual kind of, if you like, policy question or whatever is, when you talk about the partnerships case study and you said our partnership's quite resource intensive, you know, there's a lot of stories in there, I'm sure, but what, how, and then you said never say no to an intro, we try and say, so how do you judge the kind of, the resource intensity that you're going to allow a partnership to consume, you know. So yeah, when you're prioritising those partnerships, how much do you think it's worth fighting for a particular niche? Can you say a little bit more about how?
Yeah, I mean, it's real tension, right? So I don't think there's an easy answer on that. So I guess we constantly kind of review it. We try and, I guess what we try and do is build process around stuff that's not value adding to allow us more free time to explore other stuff. That would be the main way, sort of there's some stuff that we can standardize that's not standardized, that would cut back a load of manual work. So an example, how we report performance between EasyJet and all our different partners, different for every single partner, and that therefore just requires a bit of manual manipulation to consolidate and assess how you're performing as a portfolio. And kind of actually, why don't we just have one way of doing it that six partners report against? And that would free up a load of time.
You know what's really interesting about that? People think that there's two different things, right? There's sort of efficiency and cost savings, and then there's revenue growth. But a lot of businesses we talk a lot about doing the former in order to have the mental space and the investment money to do the latter. So you're not just driving efficiency so that you can drive profits, you're driving efficiency so you've got the space to think about and some of the cash to try new things. Other questions, reactions? Yeah.
The way I see the model is you've got this clever algorithm, so the yield management's fantastic on the main, should we say, main profitability of it. And then all, should we say, the fixed price things comes after that. So you're using, should we say, the algorithms to get the people who are sitting on the claims, and then you've got literally the partnerships, etc. working. Is that right in saying that?
Yeah, it's probably a scale. So the ticket revenue is super sophisticated,
yeah.
A bit of a black box, to be honest. On the other end, we've got some fixed costs,
yeah.
Some fixed fees that are flat. And in the middle, we're trying to get smarter with our bag pricing and our allocated seat pricing.
Yeah.
So they're kind of rules-based.
Okay.
Rather than super responsive.
Yeah.
But the pricing lever has driven a lot of growth. And I'm not just talking about putting the price up, I'm talking about us pricing more intelligently so that we're pricing right for the right customer in the right circumstances. So one of the things, some of my team was in Belfast at the weekend. He flew from Belfast to Edinburgh on Saturday. He looks after allocated seating. And he was kind of like, and this is where I find insight super interesting. So he found our allocated seat price really expensive for Belfast, Edinburgh on a Saturday. Because I think it was something like $5.99 to pick where you sit, but there's no one in the room, it was quite empty. And the hypothesis hypothesis, therefore, was we're pricing the same for every day of the week.
Yeah.
So we're pricing for a Monday and a Friday, but on a Saturday, it's a totally different passenger, and we're charging the same. And it only actually took him to be that passenger to develop that hypothesis, which then allows us to go and think about how we can price differently.
Yeah.
It's a really interesting thing here about understanding your customer journey. And what I like about some of these stories is that, in a way, every one of you will think you know your customer. But it's almost like you stage manage, like secret shopper style, and you stage manage customer journeys just to check yourself that you do really know your customer. Is what's the data telling you, the surveys telling you? Actually, you get a mate or a member of your team to basically come in and be the customer for a day and just spot stuff. It sounds so simple, right? I mean, some of the stuff is, you put it, you know, this massively clever, sophisticated algorithm. Some of that other stuff, it just seems like you're discovering insights just by one of you's pretending to be the customer.
But the key thing I would say on that, so I totally agree, but I think the thing to encourage whoever's doing mystery shopping is to be curious, not critical. So it's very easy to go, right, I'm going to go and critique everything that you do and tell you why things are bad. But it's much more powerful to be curious about why something is the way it is and ask questions rather than make statements.
So that, I'm going to ask you to be a brilliant advisor. So if you run a restaurant or a pub here, and you were going to send one of your team into your restaurant or pub as a secret shopper, so to speak, give me an example of the kind of things they would look for or the kind of way they'd behave in order to be, as you say, curious rather than critical.
So there's probably a couple of things. So one is to think about, try and think about emotion. So what's the emotion that, as an observer, that you are experiencing? So I'll pick an example. So you've got a wine list. Now, if it's a long wine list, how do I feel as someone that doesn't know wine that intimately? So I don't want to go, you've got too many wines in your wine list, but how does it make me feel emotionally? Does it make me excited because it means I might get to try something totally different? Does it make me nervous because I don't know where to start? But then in terms of feedback, I think the feedback needs to be, why do you have X number of wines on your wine list? Why do you serve wines from 10 different regions? So, but not as a criticism, just in order to understand what's the decision making that's led to the status that this person's experienced. And just explore it, and then the key is to try not to be defensive, and but just explore.
The emotion thing's quite interesting, right? Because if people feel intimidated, then presumably, I don't know, the restaurant and pub people will laugh at me here. Presumably, therefore, what you want to do is have things like recommended choices and,
Yeah, I mean, I absolutely don't know the answer, but I think just exploring that with someone who's just sharing their point of view, and then, because it might be that, it could be that actually just over 10 years, you just kept adding more and more wines. I'm sure this isn't a relevant case study, but often actually the outcome is not by design. It's sort of
the
circumstances.
I like that idea of understanding the emotion. You were going to come in, sorry.
Yeah, I was just thinking about pre-ordering. Were you incentivizing your customers to order earlier? Were there other, were you understanding what they wanted?
So we're not doing it very well, but absolutely. So at the moment, what we're trying to do, so it would be cheaper if you pre-order.
Yeah.
You get served first, so there's a sort of, privilege slash status starting. And then the other benefit is, you're guaranteed that the food's going to be on board, whereas, we sell out. In time, it could be that there's exclusive stock that's only available online.
Yeah.
You can't get it on the plane. Maybe it's that you, you have different geographic specialties, whatever. There's a whole load of, but at the moment we're just trying to drive traffic to it. So it is we're going to give you some money back, basically.
Yeah. So it's a way as well to have a conversation with your customer that little bit earlier as well. So hopefully, I'm just thinking all the GDPR stuff, reasons to speak to.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
The customer.
Yeah.
And I like the fact that it might be price, but it might be about value. Because I guess everyone's going to be nervous about, about giving discount away too early unless you've got the mass sophistication of the EasyJet algorithm. But the notion of adding value, and that's a positive incentive, I guess, for somebody to sign up. Other thoughts, reactions, questions? Yeah.
A question, if we just revisit your topic about what we called load factor driven pricing, because I can quite easily see that being something that would filter down to our industry here in Cornwall to perhaps overcome seasonality, good weather rapport, rewarding loyalty from people that want to book the following year. Can you think of any examples where your business has had to perhaps appease a customer who is who's paid three times as much for the same service as the customer sitting next to them, as opposed to just saying, sorry, customer A, you were later booking than customer B?
So it's a good question. So I don't think so. I think where we were as a business was we had this price promise which said if you buy, so we were always trying to encourage people to book early. So it's kind of trying to reinforce that message which says book early and we'll give you every chance. And then if you see the ticket cheaper later, we'll refund the difference. Got us in a bit of bother. So we still have a price problem, it's only for our loyalty customers now. But it doesn't always, so the load factor strategy, still stays as our strategy, but it doesn't always, pricing is not the only lever that will always work. So as part of Air Berlin collapsing, we bought 25 aircraft worth of flying essentially. But we had to put it on sale really quickly. So we've essentially grown in Berlin, more than doubled in Berlin overnight. And no matter what we do with price, we can't stimulate the level of demand that's necessary to fill those planes. So we have to think beyond price and kind of go, right, what else could we do to stimulate demand? So one of the, I have to leave it there. In terms of, but there's a load of ideas around how else could we try and stimulate demand beyond just price.
Can I just check one thing you said that was quite interesting there? So you had the price promise, which turned out to be, of course, a mistake, but you said that you'll keep it for loyal customers.
So for our loyalty customers, so people who have an EasyJet Plus card or people in our Flight Club, which are our two loyalty programs, it's one of the benefits of being the loyalty program.
I think that's kind of interesting, isn't it? The idea that, that's an extra incentive towards loyalty, right? Which is, that price promise will continue.
Yeah.
Can I just check? Are we sure that pricing approach works? Are we still sure that load factor works?
Yeah.
Do you not all get tempted by actually? Are we just throwing money away at the beginning?
So we have had our revenue management system sort of independently audited and assessed a number of times by the industry, by academics, by all sorts, and
they're pretty confident that.
But I guess load factor doesn't necessarily mean that the earlier you book, the cheaper it's going to be. So, for example, if you transition that thought pattern to hospitality, you're in a sense you're going to charge a higher price when demand is high, right?
Yeah.
So demand typically in our industry,
right,
is high as people leave because they've had a great time with us and they want to secure their place for next year.
Mm.
Whereas demand is lower, perhaps. End of the year, October, November, December time, and people aren't thinking about summer holidays.
Do you buy that?
I agree with EasyJet. I do buy that. So I don't think it doesn't need to be about price driving load factor.
Mm.
But I think load factor, or the equivalent, is super important. So you want to sell or fill or whatever your assets, right? So and we've done the analysis a number of times for us, but you have to work incredibly hard on price to compensate for having missed out on a sale on a passenger or a customer. So I think I wouldn't necessarily just default to getting good load factor means you use price cheap and then wrap it up. But I think the principle of wanting to sell out of your stock or your available customer base is the right one.
That was a really good help. You were going to come in, Tom?
Yeah, I was just going to just. I'm just interested in the interaction between the different elements of the management of the business. So a lot of businesses here just one person makes a decision. With your bagging thing of £5 a bag, that really pisses me off because I've got a small kid. I have to have a whole bag and it's going to come out later. So it's obviously, it's very, very clever marketing. How do you interact with your marketing team and who's making that decision as to what that looks like?
Yeah, so I guess, so the marketing bit was easier because we were in the same team, same function. But the momentum bit's really important for that. So we're the sort of cousin, you know, we're the long lost cousin of the ticket revenue. So marketing, everything's focused on ticket revenue, right? So we've had to work very hard to be taken seriously, but it's about getting some wins under the belt to get that support. More difficult is kind of, we think of the sort of triangle of customer, operational, and commercial. And if you hit all three of those things and you align your objectives, you know, in a way that works for all three of those stakeholders, then that's when you're on to a winner. So that's how we've tried to approach the baggage piece particularly.
But it all starts with customer, because if there's customer value, there's commercial value, and the trick is then to find operational ways to make that easier, not harder.
So I think that's the classic way of thinking about it. Is going, I'm going to tick these two boxes and then we'll work out the third one later. So I think if you can come to the party with the third one from the beginning. So that's again the hands-free example is, so the front line helped us design the product. So we had the ground ops manager from France came and kind of was sat in all our product development meetings, because actually having ground ops on board from the beginning made life a lot easier.
Do you know what's very interesting about that? Something we hear across the country is that people hear productivity and they think that means staff are the problem. But all the good stories of productivity gain are where staff had ideas.
Yeah.
And odds are your staff have got ideas about revenue, and are you finding them out? Anyway, you're going to do some work in a moment about your plans as a result of all this, but we'll take one or two more questions. So any final bits and pieces? Yeah.
I was just interested about the seasonality, because we run a kayaking business which is weather dependent, and I guess airplanes are weather dependent, and the seasonality, so obviously there's a lot of demand in the summer. We're not discounting at all out of season, but how do you cope with the seasonality of running your kayak?
Yeah, I mean it's tough. So we try and do like our engineering and maintenance, you know, in the quieter periods. So if we're taking aircraft out, we want to take it out during the down periods. We do all of our promotional stuff is around the shoulder seasons, particularly to try and stimulate demand.
What are shoulder seasons? Might be familiar to all of you.
So you've got your peak summer,
yeah,
like school holidays, which I'm sure everyone's very comfortable with. But then either side of that are our sort of shoulders. So it's sort of ramping up. We're operating a full schedule, so we're flying every aircraft as hard as we would fly in peak summer, but people aren't school holidays. So we have to work harder to fill those planes. So
why are you flying them hard?
So that's to do with the slots. So the way that
airport
slots work, you essentially have to fly them or you lose them. So I guess it's just different customer bases, how you tap into those customer bases. The unpredictability of weather, I think, is becoming worse, obviously not better, so you sort of have to plan for that, in a way.
Can I just check, if you don't throw this bit away, customer bases, you've got to tap into those customer bases. Mm-hmm. Say a little bit more about the kind of things you can do to drive off-season demand by better understanding your customer base.
So I guess some of the relatively obvious segments that you would be going after. It's an aging population, that's a rich area, but they want different things, and they probably want to go to different places as well, so we want to have a bit of flexibility on our schedule for that. I guess it's where partnership comes in, so distribution. I was having a chat earlier with someone around distribution, and actually that's a very real subject for us. Like all of you, people are trying to disaggregate us, but for some of those off peak periods, working with the right distribution partners, can be more important.
I just ask about segmentation, because we might get into this in a second, but How many hands up if you've got customer segments? 2, 3, 4 archetypes of customers. And do you call them sort of different things? They're the, you know, the older people, or they're the big spenders.
Empty nesters.
Empty nesters.
Soft adventurers.
Soft adventurers.
Yeah, they're good. But it's not defined. What I'm finding is that we've not defined it. We need to define it more.
I mean, segmentation's a real art, isn't it? Right. Final question, if there is anybody. Mark, you're getting the last word.
Like, we're all sat in your plane, and we're experiencing, hopefully, a fine journey, and our hands-free lovey is going to end up where it ends up. Have you got a target spend per head on the plane? What is that? Do you hit that? And what do you do to make sure that you hit that?
So yes, can tell you. and so we've probably got two numbers actually. So we've got a spend per seat and a spend per head. And so the difference for me, terminology is probably not even right, but the difference is we want to grow our spend per seat. And one of the ways we might be able to do that is increasing our spend per head. So for someone who buys anything from me, I want that person to increase their spend, but I want more people to buy something from me. So our problem at the moment is a very small number of people in the aircraft buy anything. But the ones who do, you spend quite a lot of money. So we want more people to be spending. So that's our focus, is driving conversion rather than driving average.
So what
spend.
Things are you doing to achieve that?
So part of it is things like the pre-order, part of it is getting the front line again incentivised, so the crew, which is essentially our sales force, so we try innovative, so their core compensation includes an element of commission from sales, but actually we try and then incentivise them through kind of promotional mechanics to, you know, try and drive growth.
What do you mean by promotional mechanics?
So they've got a core, like we are an X percent of every sale,
right.
But then we'll run a, so next month we'll run a kind of competition, so for each base, the top 10% of salespeople wearing X.
By the way, this is kind of interesting, money. Isn't it? It's interesting that the incentives are not necessarily pricing incentives. You know, there's not there might be some pricing for off-season demand, but there's an interesting idea, I mean, because all of us are people businesses in some respect. There's a sort of internal competition and incentives to help drive off-season demand. That's an interesting idea.
Yeah.
We're going to wrap up. I'm going to ask you one final totally unfair question. But you haven't come all this way. I'm not going to ask this question. What would it take Cornish Hospitality to do for EasyJet to be massively excited about getting more planes to Cornwall?
Yeah.
We'll be back after this commercial break.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough, right? So there's some infrastructure challenges with the airport, right, which hold people back. I think
Heathrow Airport.
Yeah, and we're supportive of that. So I think, yeah, I think it needs to be led from demand fundamentally. So if, and there is the pool already, right? So it's a fantastic place. I don't think our issue is with Cornish Hospitality, I think it's with the infrastructure.
Right.
So that's not a very good answer, I'm afraid. Yeah.
So what do you need infrastructure wise to make?
So there's a runway challenge. For some of our aircraft, some of our bigger aircraft.
So is that different to when you were operating?
So we do still fly smaller aircraft. And I was asked this earlier about the Manchester flight, so I'm not sure if we are still doing them.
I think we should let Andrew off the hook about the stuff that he's not in control of. I just couldn't resist the question, so I apologize.
We
have an emergency, we're out of process question, and we're to allow it.
A lot of it, too, this guy come from an airline background. A lot of it is to do with the way airlines actually operate an actual placement of the aircraft, and there's probably not enough sustainable demand for aircraft coming into Cornwall where you're going to send it afterwards. because not every airline operates on a point-to-point basis.
Yeah, understood. Good. You got him off for the before we introduce Alan for the next session, I just want to say a big thank you to Alan, who has been absolutely fantastic. Yeah, and the first half, because we've now learned from the fancy flashy airline that's got a massive algorithm that does all the work for it, and Andrew just does all the icing on the cake. So I wasn't going to say all nice things about you. The question is, what do we really do about that in this room? Alan, we're going to hand over to you for us to try and answer that question.
I will. Well,